Everybody clapping like this, come on.
The Lord.
Come on, somebody give me a good amen out there. All right. We're going to teach you a new song tonight. You guys ready to learn a new song? All right. So the chorus goes a little something like this. One, two, three. Got this heartbeat in my chest. It doesn't matter about the rest.
If I got you, Lord, I'm
sing it again. Come on. I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed.
Got this heartbeat in my chest.
It doesn't matter about the rest.
If I got you,
all right, let me hear you sing it. Come on. I'm so blessed. I'm so blessed. Got this heartbeat in my chest. Come on. Doesn't matter about the rest. If I've got you, Lord, I'm so. Let me hear you. Come on.
I'm so blessed.
Got this heartbeat in my chest. It doesn't matter about the rest.
If I got you.
All right, let me hear the church sing. Come on. I'm so. Come on, clap those hands. Come on. Everybody sing, come on, I'm so, come on. Hey! Hey, you guys sound good. All right, so here we go. We've never done this song before. This is our first time ever doing it. And so if we mess up, you're gonna love us anyway, am I right? Here we go. I'm so blessed, hallelujah, I'm blessed, I'm so blessed, hallelujah, I'm blessed.
Every day's a good day, now let me tell you why. You got air in your lungs. somebody, you are a child of God. Come on and sing
it,
somebody.
On.
Let's go.
On my best day, I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day.
Let me hear you sing on my best day. Come on,
my best day. I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day.
This church. I mean, I like the joy. I like the expression on your faces. I like the happiness in the house. But for some reason, y'all don't like to clap. I don't know why that is. Can we get some clapping going in here? One, two, ready, everybody, come on. See how much better that sounds? See all the energy now we have in the house? And plus, that helps my man Avery break it down like this. Come on, it's your best day.
Air in your lungs, you got blood in your body, you are a child of God. Come on,
come on, everybody.
Let's go.
On my best day, I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day, and you're the reason why.
Come on.
On my best day, I'm a child of God. On my worst day, I'm a child of God. Oh, every day is a good day.
Hey. On my best day,
I'm a child of God.
On my worst day,
I'm a child of God.
Oh, every day is a good day. Chorus, here we go, come on.
I'm so blessed, got this heartbeat in my chest. It doesn't matter about the rest. If I got you, Lord, I'm so blessed.
I'm so blessed,
I'm so blessed. Got this heartbeat.
Y'all sound good tonight. Come on, can you lift your hands to heaven? Let's welcome the presence of the Lord into the house. Lord, we've come to meet with you today. Lord, we know that with every struggle and every battle, oh God, that you are there with us, Lord. And it is in the name of Jesus that we have victory over all our enemies, Lord, over the flesh, over the devil, and over the world. We worship you, we worship you, we worship you. Can you lift your voice in the house and just call upon his name?
greatness of his power to us who believe and are according to his working and his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and he set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. He's far above all principality, all power, all might, and dominion, and every name that is named, not only in this world, but in the world that is to come. And God hath put all things under his feet and given him to be head over all things to the church, which is his body, the fullness which filleth all in all, who is the image of the invisible God, the firstborn of every creature. For by him were all things created, whether they're in heaven or whether they're on earth, whether they're visible or invisible, whether they be thrones or dominions or principalities or powers. All things were created by him and for him, and he is before all things, and through him all things consist. And he is the head of the body, the church, who is the beginning, the firstborn from the dead, that all in all things he might have the preeminence. For it pleased the Father that in him should all the fullness dwell. And wherefore God hath also highly exalted him, and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee shall bow, and of things in heaven, and things on earth, things under earth, and that every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, that Jesus Christ is Lord, that Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord.
Hallelujah. Every voice will proclaim there is.
Would you sing?
You're the name above all names.
Come on, give the Lord praise in his house. sing this.
Oh, there's
of the Lord tonight. We are so glad you're here. Would you go around and shake hands with 20 or 30 people and tell them you're glad to see them in the house of the Lord
tonight.
Tonight. Thank you.
What's up, worship gathering? It's Morgan. We have a few quick announcements before we jump into the sermon.
For all of you who are visiting with us tonight, or you've been coming over the last couple of weeks, make sure you stop by the Welcome Center on your way out. We have a very special gift for you.
This is a rented facility, so make sure you only bring water into the sanctuary and enjoy your coffee and treats out in the foyer.
At the worship gathering, we're about three things: changing lives, preaching the gospel, and making disciples. We do that through our four-part process: inspiring hearts, renewing minds, connecting people, and serving others.
Worship gathering family, we would love to pray for you. You can fill out your prayer request on the prayer card in your bulletin and put it in the offering when it goes your way.
Here at the worship gathering, we got your whole family covered. We got from newborn to 12th grade. So everybody come out, and we hope to see you there.
Our April women's gathering will be called Bloom. The cost of this event is $35. Text Bloom to pre-register. Dinner will be served, so come hungry.
Here at the worship gathering, we have three ways to give. You can give in service, you can text this number, or you can give online. Now we're going to pray over our tithes and offerings.
Hey, I like that new song. That was awesome. You guys crushed it. I think they did, yeah. Okay, my name's Crystal Factora. I am the admin assistant here at the worship gathering. I'm going to give you a few housekeeping things before we get on with the service. Firstly, we want to welcome our guests and visitors. So if you guys will give a round of applause to the new faces we have here tonight, that would be great. We are so happy that you guys are here with us tonight. If you'll open your bulletin, looks like this. You have a connection card in there, looks like this. If you would like to fill that out, if this is your first, second, third time here and you've never filled one of these out before, go ahead and do that, and then when you finish filling it out, you can take it to the welcome table in the foyer after service, and you'll get a free gift. Yeah. So that's exciting. There's a $1,000 gift card in there, so, you know, you might want to do that. same. Okay, so tonight we were supposed to have a pie night, but it's been postponed till June because we just didn't have enough people signed up. So if you would like to be a part of that, it's our pastor's informational event. We'll be giving you more information about that when that time comes. But that one that's supposed to be tonight is postponed. And then for Bloom, for our women's event, we have four tickets left, ladies. Let's get those sold. You guys take them so we can sell out the house. And thank you for all your help. Four tickets left, ladies. So if you have not signed up and paid, when's the last day, Miss Bobby? Oh, today's your last day. So let's get those bought. Next thing is we have a serve team dinner coming up on April 21st. So if you're on our serve team, that's if you're a volunteer and you help out in any ministry here, we're going to have dinner for you guys after service on the 21st. So even if you've only served like one time, you still are welcome to come. And we will send you out an invite tomorrow with all the information so that you guys can RSVP and let us know if you're bringing kids or whatever, and we'll have a nice dinner for you. I think that is it. So let's pray over tithes and offerings. Bow your heads, close your eyes. Lord, we just thank you for this night, Lord. We thank you for your goodness and your mercy every single day. And Father, we praise you for the tithes and offerings that will come in tonight, Lord. May it further your kingdom and build this house up and provide a building for us. Lord, we praise you and we thank you for it right now, for the answered prayers and the things that you will do through your givers here at the worship gathering. We pray that you would bless the giver and the gift. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen. Hey, listen, I am super stoked to tell you about something. There's a few of us from this church, along with some other guys, that started a fellowship at Bear Valley Country Club called Links Fellowship. Its purpose is to share the love of Christ through the game of golf. It's at 7 a.m. Gilby Boy, he thinks that, you know, people should be cheerful and happy at 6 a.m. That's from the devil. Matt, too, that is from the devil. There's a proverb about that. It says, if your neighbor shouts good morning at you too early, it's considered a curse, not a blessing. That's in the Bible. But we gathered together, and man, we had one of the men that was there said, oh, well, I guess what you need to pray for me is, this is all new to me. I'm still, I guess, what you would call an unbeliever. Just pray that God would give me the faith to believe. But after the meeting, I received a text message from one of the guys. This is what he said. He said, I want to thank you personally for inviting me to this group. I know you asked me a few months back that if you got something going, would I be interested? This is a good mixture of maturity levels in their walk with the Lord. I'm looking forward to this every week. Thank you again, brother. I am praying for you and your business. You are a great example of what a Christian should look like, and I would hope that you would keep me accountable as well. Love you, brother. I responded with, what else can I say other than that just made my day? If you're feeling discouraged, the best remedy to feeling discouraged is to encourage somebody else. You could get up every day and just scroll through your contacts and allow the Holy Spirit to prick your heart about who you could send a message to. And if it's nothing else, just to say, I was thinking about you today, and I just want you to know that I love and appreciate you, and I'm glad that God brought you into my life. You don't know when that message may be that word of encouragement that breaks the plan of the enemy for them that day. You know, we've got three enemies, right? We have the world, we have our flesh, and we have the devil. And any one or all three could be putting the full court press. You could have the triple team on your life. I remember my dad, who is just a tremendous example of what it is to serve God and walk with him. But I remember one of the things he passed on to me is he said, son, you should make it your goal every day to make somebody else's day. Because the way up is down. Somebody help Pastor preach right now. Had to change out the batteries. What's up, people? Hey, a couple of things. First of all, with the women's event, we got 4 tickets left. I am going to buy one of them. I need 3 other people to raise their hand to buy the other 3, so we're sold out, and then we're going to give those tickets away. So I need 3 other people. I'm going to buy the first one. Who's okay, we got 2, 3, and did I see a hand back there? 4. All right, here's how you do that. All right, cool. We're sold out now. All right, good job. Okay, here's how you do that. Everybody get your cell phone out. You're going to text the word bloom, and is it 35? 35 bloom, sorry. Text 35, the number 35, and then bloom to 760-933-3300. 760-933-3300. I'm going to say it again. I sound like an infomercial, right? That's 760-933-3300. Don't wait. Call now. If you send that money in the next 15 minutes, Miss Bobby will make you an extra plate of enchiladas. 760-933-3300. What are you guys serving at that event? Food-wise. Italian food. Yeah. She's going to run down to Vince's Spaghetti and get a few pans of... Now we're talking. All right, 760-933-3300. Text 35 and the word bloom. And let's fill the place up. That way you got a ticket to give away to somebody. And bring a friend. Somebody say, bring a friend. All right. Second thing is, hey, have you noticed that we have some mighty men of God, some people from the band of brothers patrolling this place, providing security for the house. Isn't that awesome? And we have a great group of guys doing that. We want every man in this church serving in some way. And so if you're not on the security team, you can be on the hospitality team or the welcome team, or you could be an usher. We want every single man in this church serving, every single man in this church leading their family, serving their church. Somebody help Pastor Brian preach. Amen, Pastor. Hey, we had a great time at the hockey night the other night, and it was close. It went into overtime, and we almost had a few fights, which was pretty cool, but the refs kept breaking it up. I said, what that tells me, they didn't really want to fight. Like, if you want to fight, like, you deck somebody, right? You don't just talk. And then the refs get involved. Hockey's gone soft. All right, turn in your Bibles to the book of 2 Thessalonians. And as you're going there, I want to bring to your remembrance in the run-up to the 2016 election. First of all, I would like for everybody to reminisce for a minute. Just go back to the days. Some of you won't be able to do this because you're too young. But for those of us that have a little bit of gray right here, okay? A little bit of gray. You know what this means, Ryan? This means I'm full of wisdom. Amen. And this means that I got the cue ball gene from my mom's part of the family, apparently. I don't know. That's what they say. Although my son, he has the same thing going on, so he must have got it from me. Amen. Okay, so let's go back a little bit. Reminisce. Do you remember before there was such thing as social media? Remember that? Remember before we had Instagram? Before we had Facebook? Before we had Twitter, now known as X? Before we had MySpace? Did anybody have a MySpace? Remember having a MySpace? You'd open it up and you had a song that you could pick that would play when you opened it up. And when you first opened it, all of a sudden this guy named Tom showed up and he was looking at you like, oh, who's this guy, right? Your only friend. But before the days of social media, let's just say a lot of what we deal with in the world today is because of social media. There's a lot of things that would not be a thing if we didn't have the issues surrounding social media. And one of the things that's changed in the advent of social media, and I don't remember the last time how many users there are on Facebook, but it's an astronomical number. It's literally billions of people are on Facebook, and that doesn't include the other social media platforms. So in the run-up to the 2016 election, there was a phrase that was coined actually 2 years ago by a journalist named Craig Silverman. And it was to describe the falsehoods, the rumors, the gossip, the things that people would put, you know, kind of as headlines on social media to get people to click. Does anybody remember what the phrase was that became so popular in the run-up to the 2016 election? Fake news. Who said it back there? Somebody did say fake news back there, right? No, they said something else? Okay. Well, so the phrase is fake news. Everybody say fake news. One more time, say, how many of you have ever looked at something and you click on it and you realize that you're going down a rabbit hole and you're reading something that hasn't been verified, that it's full of half-truths and falsehoods? Fake news. And fake news became such an issue because there were a lot of things going around about both Donald Trump and Hillary Clinton that was some of it true and some of it not true. And if you're on one side or the other, you click on it and you want something to be true. So you're apt to believe it. People use fake news to manipulate people, to control people, and to deceive people, ploying on their greatest fears or on their greatest hopes. And so, you know, they kind of use both of them to get you to click on it and look at it. Let me give you an example. How many of you have ever heard that Gavin Newsom is Nancy Pelosi's nephew? Wave your hand at me if you've ever heard that. Did you know that that's fake news? That is not true. It's not true at all. In fact, if you were to describe them as family, it would be being very generous. It was like it was somebody on his side used to be married to somebody on her side, and if they were still, which they're not married anymore, and if they were still married, they would be relatives three times removed only by marriage. So it's not true that Gavin Newsom is Nancy Pelosi's nephew, and yet in certain precincts of social media, everybody believes this. It's called what? Come on, say it again. It's called what? Now, it would seem that when you read our text tonight, and here we are in week 10 of our sermon series, The Coming of the Lord. And if you've not been here, you're new. We've been covering the books of 1st and 2nd Thessalonians, and there is an underlying theme in the book about the coming of the Lord. Literally every chapter in the book addresses the coming of the Lord, which is why we titled the sermon series, that name. 2 Thessalonians is the second of two letters written to the church in Thessalonica. It's a church that the Apostle Paul planted in around the year A.D. 50. He was chased out of town. He was worried about the church, so he sent Timothy to check on them. And Timothy came back with a report that in spite of persecution, in spite of the fact that they were a young church, that they were still flourishing in their faith, they were still growing in the Lord, they were still serving God. And so in response to that report, Paul penned 1 Thessalonians. And then shortly thereafter, within just a few months, he wrote a second letter, 2 Thessalonians, perhaps in response to the report on how they received the first letter. Now, in the three chapters of 2 Thessalonians, we find the purpose of Paul's writing the letter. And just to make sure, I have everybody with me and that everybody's full of energy and you have ears to hear, can I get an amen?
Amen.
All right, not bad. And so the more you amen me, the better I preach.
Amen.
And the shorter the sermon is.
Amen.
Okay, I'm just going to keep preaching. And we're going to keep preaching until I get a good amen. All right. So 2 Thessalonians, the purpose of the letter, threefold. Chapter 1, it was to comfort the church. Chapter 1 was to comfort the church. Chapter 2 was to counsel the church. That's what we're going to be talking about tonight. And then chapter 3 was to correct the church, and we will be dealing with that here in just a couple of weeks. Now, last week we covered chapter 1, which contains a word of encouragement for this gathering of believers who they were enduring some pretty heavy trials. And we talked about last week, here's a church that is a young church. You know, they don't have any of the power, prestige, wealth that many churches in the American church have today. They didn't own property. They didn't have technology. They didn't have a sound system. They didn't have a bad daddy drummer like Luke. They didn't have any of that stuff. And yet they were flourishing in their faith. They remained faithful in spite of inconveniences, in spite of discomfort, in spite of persecution. And I'm sure that as they were seeking to remain faithful to the Lord, sometimes it felt discouraging in their walk. How many of you know it is fake news to teach people that if you come to faith in Christ, your life is going to be full of peaches and watermelon and strawberries and lollipops and unicorns? You're going to have no trouble. Your life's going to be full of nothing but peace and joy and happiness, that your life is going to be so much better because you came to faith in Jesus. How many know that that is not always true? And how many know that it is sometimes true that you come to faith in Jesus, at least for a season, your life gets worse, right? It comes at great sacrifice for some people. When they come to faith in Christ, they lose good friends. Some people lose family members because of their faith in Christ, because of their walk, because Jesus changes us. He changes our thoughts, our habits, the things in our heart. Our heart becomes different. We desire different things. The things that used to please us don't please us anymore. And how many of you have found that to be true in your life? That you look back at where you were before Christ and you're like, man, that's just not my scene anymore. Jared and Tony talked to me, it was probably a year or two ago. They said, man, we went to Vegas. I'm just telling you right now, we didn't like it. That's just not our scene. And we used to love it, but that's not who we are anymore. Now, understand, I'm not being legalistic. I'm just saying that Jesus changes our heart, and when he changes our heart and you're around people whose hearts haven't been changed, sometimes you go in divergent directions. And you may even find yourself being made fun of or ostracized or persecuted. Somebody asked somebody in our church, I'm trying to remember who it was, they said, so let me get this straight. You're a member of a cult, right? I was like, sure. I don't know what that means. In my mind, a cult, it means somebody that is controlling and they're preaching a false doctrine. They have a different Bible, a different Jesus, a different God. How many know that's not us? But we are people who are fired up for Jesus. We are people who are in love with him. We are people who have a passion. We are people who are not afraid to express our emotion because of how much we love him. And if that means you want to call me a member of a cult, I don't care. You can call me whatever you want to call me as long as I'm pleasing him. Am I right? And so maybe that First Thessalonians church, they were experiencing some discouragement. So Paul wrote them to encourage them. And then now we come to chapter 2, and it's about how Paul is counseling them. He's instructing them. He's bringing some clarity to them in regards to some fake news that they had been getting that brought about confusion in the church. So before we get to that, I'm going to invite you, let's all stand to our feet for the reading of the Word of God. And before we get to our text, I want us to go over our memory verse, which is 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 9, and I think 10, 9 and 10, if I remember right. 9b and 10. All right, so everybody read it with me. Are you ready? You turn to God from idols to serve the living and true God, to wait for a son from heaven who he raised from the dead, Jesus, who delivers us from the wrath. Come on, how many of you are glad Jesus delivers us from the wrath to come? And we're going to talk about that here in just a minute. But now we turn to our text that we're teaching tonight. That's 2 Thessalonians chapter 2. We're going to begin reading in verse number 1. It says, now concerning the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ and our being gathered together to him, we ask you, brothers, not to be quickly shaken in mind or alarmed, either by a spirit or a spoken word or a letter seeming to be from us, to the effect that the day of the Lord has come. Let no one deceive you. That's the title of our sermon tonight, right? Let no one deceive you in any way. You could paraphrase it by saying, don't believe the fake news. For that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first and the man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. Do you remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things? I'm just reading through this, and that verse now just pops up with me. So he's saying to them, hey, man, I already taught you this. Come on, how many of you want to confess right now? Sometimes you hear something, and then you wander away from what you were taught, right? And so he's saying, listen, man, I already taught you all this. Come on, man. Why are you believing the fake news? I've already dealt with you. And then verse 6. And you know what is restraining him now so that he may be revealed in his time. For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he is out of the way. And then the lawless one will be revealed, whom the Lord Jesus will, I love this, kill with the breath of his mouth. Now listen, man, sometimes, you know, Altoids are a pastor's best friend. And I try to always have them in my pocket. Because when I'm praying with people, I put an Altoid in. So when I'm praying with them, if they fall out, it's the Lord and not my kicking breath, right? Right? But here it is. I don't think Jesus is killing him with kicking breath. He's killing him with fire coming out of his mouth, okay? And a sword coming out of his mouth. He says he's going to kill him with the breath of his mouth and to bring to nothing by the appearance of his coming. The coming of the lawless one is by the activity of Satan with all power and false signs and wonders and with all wicked deception. There it is again, right? For those who are perishing because they refuse to love the truth and so be saved. Stop right there. Isn't it interesting that the hardness of heart, the refusal to believe, the refusal to come to faith in Christ, the refusal to submit myself to him, the refusal, because remember we talked about it in the book of Mark, the Greek word was apostia, right? That it was rebellion. It was not just, I don't believe, it's I don't want to believe. And the reason most people don't want to believe is because they don't want to change. Oh, that's good preaching right there. Amen. Am I right? Isn't it interesting how the condition of somebody's heart who becomes hard, they rebel, they gnash their teeth, they turn away from God is what leads them into deception. That the condition of your heart is what will lead you into a place of being deceived. And so what we're saying tonight is don't let anybody deceive you. And so you know what that means? That means first and foremost that we get our hearts right with the Lord. Because in getting our hearts right with the Lord, now we have an open and clear mind to receive from the Word of God. Verse 11. Look at there. Here it is. Therefore, God sends them a strong delusion. So not only are they deceived, they're delusional. So that they may believe what is false. In order that all may be condemned who did not believe the truth, but had pleasure in unrighteousness. Man, there's some truth bombs there, right? Man, that's who we used to be. We used to have pleasure in unrighteousness. Now we take pleasure in something else. We delight ourselves in the Lord. And it is then that he gives us the desires of our heart. So we no longer take pleasure in unrighteousness. So the difference between being saved and unsaved, when we're saved, it doesn't mean that we no longer have a sin nature that we battle. It means that we think and feel different about our sin nature. We used to take pleasure in it. Now we hate it. Somebody help me now. We used to just indulge in it. Now we fight it. And we never stop fighting it, right? We crucify the sinful nature. So with that, let's pray and let's ask God to speak to us through his word tonight. Lord, we pray your blessing on the reading, the preaching, the teaching, and above all, the application of your word. May it not return void into you, God, but I'm praying right now in this moment that you will open every heart, mind, and ear, and that it will go forth and find its way into fertile soil, and that it will produce fruit in our lives. And that when we leave here tonight, we will leave here different than how we came in. That we will incrementally, with each week at our blessed church, be changed to be more like you. And we pray this in the name of Jesus, the strong Son of God, and all of God's people said, amen. You may be seated. Okay. So here's what's happening. Apparently, after Paul left the Thessalonian church, there were some false teachers that came in behind him and started spreading fake news, started playing on their emotions, started tapping into their greatest hopes and their greatest fears, telling them that the day of the Lord had already come, that they had missed it. So if you were here a few weeks ago, it was week 7, when we covered chapter 5 of 1 Thessalonians. If you were not here, you can go back and watch it on our YouTube channel. We talked about what the day of the Lord means. And so if you were not here, I can kind of give you a little bit of a synopsis. The Greek word, there's a single Greek word that summarizes this idea of the day of the Lord. It is the Greek word parousia. Everybody say parousia. And the parousia, or the day of the Lord, is twofold. It is both the great and terrible time of God's judgment on the wicked. And it is also the ultimate fulfillment and restoration of the righteous. That's the day of the Lord. So we talked about how, you know, people, they wrestle with in the area of apologetics or a defense of the faith, that one of the objections to Christianity is if there's a loving God, how come he doesn't step in and stop all of the evil in the world? How could a loving God allow, you know, rape and torture and child abuse and, you know, human trafficking and all of these things that goes on in the wicked hearts of men? And we talked about, first of all, that, you know, we're very subjective, we're very selective in how much evil we want God to step in and stop. We don't want him to necessarily step in and stop our evil, but we want him to step in and stop everybody else's. But the second thing is, we talked about, is just because he has not stepped in yet does not mean he is not going to. He is going to. The day of the Lord is coming. The day of the Lord is coming. He is going to step in. And he is, remember we talked about this on Palm Sunday, the first time, you know, that, you know, when Jesus came in the triumphant entry, he was riding a donkey because donkeys were representative of a king bringing peace and representing peace because Jesus came the first time humble, lowly, right? Made himself nothing according to the book of Philippians, taking on the very nature of a servant, being made in human likeness. I mean, the great God who created everything, by him all things were created, by him and for him they were created, right? That in the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and he became flesh, lowly. The omnipotent became helpless. The omniscient had to learn how to read and write and do arithmetic, right? The creator of all the universe had to learn how to, you know, be potty trained. I mean, he experienced the human condition just like we did because he came to bring peace. And that's what the angels sang, right? Peace on earth, goodwill toward men. And he came as a lamb to be sacrificed. Like we learned through the book of Mark, the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many. That's how he came the first time. But how many of you know that day? There's coming a day when he will not be the lamb, but the lion of the tribe of Judah. Not going to be riding a donkey, but he's going to be riding a horse. There's going to be fire in his eyes and a sword in his mouth and a tattoo on his leg that says King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he's going to destroy all his enemies and all evil and wipe it all out. That day is coming. Amen. That day is coming. In verse 1 of our text, we see two things in verse 1. Can you put verse 1 up there? Now concerning the what? Coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you see that? And our being what? Okay, so we talk about this church. We believe and teach a pre-tribulation rapture. We understand that not all Christians agree on that eschatology. But this is our position at this church, is that the coming of the Lord is encapsulated by the rapture of the church. We read about that in 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, verses 16 and 17. The Lord himself will descend from heaven with a shout, with the trump of God, with the voice of the archangel. The dead in Christ will rise first, and then we who are alive and remain will be what? Caught up. Somebody say caught up. To meet the Lord in the air. Cracks me when people say, the rapture's not in the Bible. Really? Yes, it is. 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, 16 and 17 says, we who are alive and remain will be what? Caught up. The Greek word there is harpazo. So if you don't like the word rapture, which comes from the Latin translation of the Bible, rapturo, that's where we get our English word rapture. If you don't like that, then fine, just call it the harpazo, which is the Greek word. But there's going to be a catching away of God's people, and we will be gathered together with him in the clouds. I like that, right? And what we teach is that's the beginning of a seven-year period of tribulation on which God will pour out his wrath. You can read about that starting in Revelation chapter 4 with the seven trumpets, the seven bowls, and the seven seals that are open, each one increasingly God's wrath being poured out on the earth. And then at the end of the tribulation, Antichrist will gather the nations of the world to do battle with Israel. And isn't it amazing what we're reading in the headlines just yesterday? How all of this, you just look and you're like, my goodness, man, it's just all starting to happen. The Bible in Ezekiel chapters 38 and 39, the battle of Gog and Magog, specifically names the countries or the people from regions of the world which are modern day Russia, Iraq, and Turkey will conspire together to do battle with Israel. You can read it for yourself. And that's the Battle of Armageddon. And at the end of the seven-year tribulation, that's when we're going to have the second coming. So there's the two things. We see it, right? We see the second coming, and then we have the gathering of the believers to him. And then in verse 2, we see that there were some people spreading fake news in the church, saying that the day of the Lord had already come. And you know what's worse about this? Is that they were using spiritual things to deceive people. Man, I watched a four-hour video of a very famous TV evangelist who they just, man, did a documentary on this guy and exposed him and how he would manipulate people, tap into their greatest fears and their greatest hopes to deceive them, all to line his own pockets. He was one of these guys that would say, hey, man, the way to tap into prosperity is for you to give. You see the number on your screen. The Lord is telling you right now, if you went out of debt, you need to send $1,000 to our ministry. And just absolutely using spiritual things to manipulate, control, and deceive people. And that's what was happening here in the Thessalonian church. And the three ways they were doing it is a big red question mark. We should have the Jeopardy theme song going. Doo, doo, doo. All right, if you have your notes, I'll just tell you what they are. The first was that they were, people were giving fake prophetic words. Fake prophetic words. And it's possible that literally people were standing up giving a message in tongues and there would be an interpretation in the services. And it would go something like, you know, thus says the Lord, the day of the Lord has already come, you've missed it, these kinds of things. I was listening to a pastor teaching on this text this week, and he said in his church many years ago, somebody came into his church, and this is a long time ago, but he stood up and he said, thus saith the Lord, the Antichrist has been revealed. The Antichrist is Ronald Reagan. Fake news. Fake news. Every U.S. president in my lifetime has been called the Antichrist. Fake news. Somebody help me now. Man, the left, you know, they'll say, oh, it's Donald Trump. He's the Antichrist. The right will say, nah, it's Barack Obama. He's the Antichrist. Fake news. Fake news. Fake news. The Antichrist has not yet been revealed. And we're going to talk about that here in just a minute. The second way that they would bring about deception was through fake sermons. You know, there would be some guy standing up there preaching, but the sermons were fake. And then the third way that they were bringing about a deception is that apparently they had literally, you know, wrote a letter and forged Paul's name on it and said, this is from, you know, the Apostle Paul, and he's saying that the day of the Lord had already come. Remember this. You've heard me say this before. I'm going to say it again. When God speaks, he always sounds like his word. So I want everybody to say that with me. When God speaks, he always sounds like his word. The word of God is the court of appeals. To test every word that somebody brings that we hear. I'm telling you right now, if you hear somebody prophesying that they know when the day of the Lord is, that they know when the rapture is going to take place, that they're saying it's going to be in such and such year, it's going to be in such and such day. I remember back in the day when we were kids, somebody wrote a book called 88 Reasons the Lord is Coming Back in 1988. And when the Lord didn't come back in 1988, they wrote another book called 89 Reasons Why the Lord is Coming Back in 1989. Literally, one of the cults was started because of this, because they kept predicting when the Lord would return, and they would do the whole white robe thing and stand on a mountain, wait for him to come, and he didn't come, and then they would do it again, he didn't come, and after the third time, they say, oh, he really did come. He just came in spirit, and now he lives in the watchtower in Brooklyn. Yep, it's a true story. Look it up. So if you hear somebody prophesying or giving a word that they know when Jesus is going to return, run, 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 Forrest. Why? Because Jesus told us no one knows. No one knows the day or the hour. You don't know and I don't know. Stop predicting the dates. You are allowed only to discern the time and seasons, but not the day or the hour. Somebody help me preach. Amen. Pastor Brian. And then in verse 3, we read, Paul instructing the church, let no one deceive you. And this should be the disposition of every Christian. You should have a healthy skepticism for anybody who claims to be speaking for the Lord. Okay? So you don't take what they say at face value, because every time God speaks, he sounds like his word. Churches get weird when they veer away from teaching the word of God. And they go into things about, oh, these are secret things. These are things that were previously concealed, but are now, we're getting extra revelation. Now we have more understanding. The Spirit is letting us know the glitter is coming down. The gold are appearing in your mouth. We have special revelation. Run, run. Where is that in the word? Where is it? Stop it. When God speaks, he always sounds like his word. This is how you refuse to allow anybody to deceive you, including me. We all need to be like the Bereans. Acts 17 and verse 11. Here's what it says about the Bereans. The Berean Jews were more noble than those in Thessalonica. They received the word with all eagerness, look at it, examining the scriptures daily to see if these things were so. So you don't just take what I say at face value. You don't take what any of the other great preachers that we have come and stand in this pulpit. By the way, I don't allow people to stand in this pulpit unless I know they're going to preach the word of God. Okay? And the nanosecond I hear somebody preaching somebody something weird, they're either A, going to be immediately yanked, like I'll have a cane, just whoop, yank them off the platform, or you're going to get correction on their error from this pulpit. But here's the thing. You should be examining everything that's said to see if you're hearing the truth. Let no one deceive you. Somebody give me a good amen out there. So the Apostle Paul is wanting to clear up the confusion. Can I have some more water, please? By the way, I guess I understand why you do the baby gap water bottles, but can you give Pastor a real water bottle every week? Like, can I get a special one? And then we got this natural spring water, which is from the... We're not drinking that one. Not drinking any of those. Here he comes to save the day. Let's hear it for Tyler. Good job, Tyler. And pro tip. When you set my water bottle on here, can you just twist the cap to where it's already open? So, because like it's awkward, like I'm dropping the mic. Okay. So earlier I had to set it down and you guys were looking at me where it's like, because I'm trying to open the bottle, okay? All right. To clear up the confusion, the Apostle Paul writes the letter and he tells him, okay, you've heard the day of the Lord has already come. That's fake news. Let me clear up the confusion. Here's some things that have to happen before the day of the Lord. Number one, the great rebellion. The great rebellion. Say that with me, the great rebellion. Let no one deceive you in any way, for that day will not come unless the rebellion comes first. Here's the Greek word, apostasy. Or apostaseia. And that's where we get our English word, apostasy. What does it mean? It means a departure. It means a following away. It means a defection from the truth. A defection from the truth. I saw somebody post on their Facebook page, or maybe it was Twitter. It said, name something you never heard in the 80s. Name something you ever heard in the 80s. You know what the first thing came to my mind was? What's your pronoun? Like, you didn't hear that in the 80s, okay? Because we have a greater falling away from truth in our culture. And this idea of a defection of people turning away from the truth is something that we see iterated in other places in the scripture. So Jesus said in Matthew 24, verses 10 through 12, This is in the Olivet Discourse. He's teaching about the end times. He says, many will fall away and betray one another and hate one another. Many false prophets will arise and will lead many astray. And because lawlessness will be increased, look at this, the love of many will grow cold. So the love that people have in their hearts will start to grow cold. The love that they have for the Lord, the love they have for their family, the love that they have for other people. Paul wrote to Timothy in his last letter, 2 Timothy chapter 3, verses 1 through 5. It says, but understand this, in the last days there will come times of difficulty. People will be, look at it, everybody read it with me, ready? People will be what? Lovers of self, lovers of money, proud, arrogant, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, heartless, unappeasable, slanderous, without self-control, brutal, not loving good, treacherous, reckless, swollen with conceit, lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God, having the appearance of godliness. Ooh. Avoid such people. Here just recently, Sean Puff Daddy P. Diddy, whatever they're calling him now, Combs, who has stood at microphones, at award ceremonies, and given thanks to God, having the appearance of godliness, we find out has been trafficking minors for sexual favors and things. Lovers of pleasure rather than lovers of God. Lovers of self, arrogant. You read that list, you're like, man, is that ever what we see in Hollywood? This is a description of so many precincts in our culture, that there would be this falling away. And here's what's disconcerting to me, fam, is not only do we see an increase in hostility to the Lord in our culture, but we're seeing an increase in hostility toward the Lord and toward God's people in the church. It has become a trend over the last few years where you're seeing more and more Christians, including pastors. There was a pastor of a mega church over in, I believe it was Virginia, who resigned his church. This man had written books. He had a huge ministry. Many people saved in this man's ministry. He turned away. He says, I'm no longer a Christian. I'm renouncing my faith. And I am now turning away from the Lord. Worship leaders, famous songwriters. I mean, the man who wrote one of my favorite worship songs, oh, praise the name of the Lord our God, one of my favorite songs, fell away, turned away from the faith, says that he no longer believes in what the trend is called the deconstruction of their faith. If you were here for our last day series, you may recall me teaching you about this idea of the cup of iniquity. Stay with me, fam. I know it's 6:30. I'm going to get through this as fast as I can, so don't check out on me. This is based on the idea that God measures the actions of mankind. Every time we do wrong, we add sin to the cup. We add more sin to the cup. Remember the book of Romans, it says that the wrath of God, if we're not in Christ, is being stored up on us. And the cup is getting just a little more full, and the cup is getting just a little more full, and a little more full, and a little more full, until there comes a time when God runs out of patience. Because that's what it says. It says, why hasn't the Lord come, right? 2 Peter chapter 3 and verse 9, if I remember. Why hasn't the Lord come yet? Where is this coming that you talk about? Where is he? And the text tells us the Lord is not slow, as some understand slowness, but he is patient with us, not wanting anyone to perish, but for all to come to repentance. Aren't you glad the Lord was patient with you? Aren't you glad the Lord gave you time to come to him? Come on, somebody. I mean, we want the Lord to return, but come on, how many know that there's still people that need to be saved? But there's going to come a time where people will no longer listen. And throughout the course of the last 2,000 years, there's been times of increasing wickedness. And then God would send messengers to preach the gospel, and people would get right and turn their hearts away, or turn their hearts away from evil, just like we read in verse 9. You turned your hearts from idols. You turned from idols to serve the living and true God. But there's going to come a day where people stop repenting, people stop believing, where the cup of iniquity would be full. Remember what Jesus said in Luke chapter 19, again, the Olivet Discourse. He said, as it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. As it was in the days of Lot, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. What happened in each of those two scenarios? In Noah's day, God looked on the earth, the Bible says, and that he was sorry he even made people. How many of you sometimes look around and say, I can relate, God. I can see why you were sorry you even made us, right? And he said, that's it. I'm going to wipe them all out. And he sent a flood. He says, but what? Noah found grace in the eyes of the Lord. Unmerited favor. There was the one family that Noah was righteous and served God. And then as it was in the days of Lot, remember what happened where God, he says, I got to find out if what I'm hearing, the cries of the abused, the sexually abused in the city and the wickedness, I got to know if this is true. And do you remember what he said? That's it. I'm wiping them out. And you remember Abraham was Lot's nephew, and Abraham was like, hey, God, listen, man, if I can find 100 righteous people, will you spare? He says, yeah, I'll spare it for 100. He says, will you do it for 50? He says, yeah, I'll do it for 50. Will you do it for 20? Yep, 20. Well, let's keep bartering. What about 10? What about 10? He says, I'll spare it for 10. They couldn't find 10 righteous people in that city. And God said, that's it. My patience is done. And God sent fire and brimstone, you remember? And God told Lot, get out of Sodom and Gomorrah, get out of there. And Lot turned and looked, or Lot's wife turned and looked back, and she turned to a pillar of salt, because you could take Lot's wife out of Sodom, but you couldn't get Sodom out of her. There's coming a time, as it was in the days of Noah, as it was in the days of Lot, where the cup of iniquity is going to be full and Jesus is going to step in. And based on these scriptures, it's my opinion that with each season of the increase in the intensity of wickedness, God sends messengers to preach the gospel. And the time is going to come where people no longer listen. They stiffen their necks. They refuse to repent. And God's going to step in and pour out his wrath. Number two. So the first of all, the great rebellion has to come. Number two, the man of lawlessness, it will be revealed. This is in verses 3 and 4. The man of lawlessness is revealed, the son of destruction, who opposes and exalts himself against every so-called God or object of worship, so that he takes his seat in the temple of God, proclaiming himself to be God. Man, our production, lighting, and everything is so much better now than it was then. But I encourage you guys to go back and find our last day in the last days series. We cover so much of this stuff in that series of messages as we talk about the end times and we talk about the things that are coming. But who is the man of lawlessness? Well, this is the Antichrist, the Antichrist, who's going to come on the scene and he's going to embody everything that is opposed to Jesus, everything that is opposed to God in the tribulation period. And he's going to be revealed. So it's going to start where he'll sign this treaty with Israel, 7 years of peace, 7 years of peace. And the Jews are going to buy into it. Israel's going to buy, and they're going to say, yep, this is it, man. This is Messiah. This is the one. And they're going to buy into it. He's going to broker the peace deal. But he'll be revealed. Their eyes will be open halfway through the tribulation period when he sets himself up into the rebuilt temple. Did you know that the Temple Mount Institute, they already have the plans to have that temple rebuilt? That the Dome of the Rock is where the Temple Mount is, or where it's supposed to be, and that's what's keeping them from building that temple. Some people say maybe there's an alternative site. We won't get into that. But I don't know if you saw yesterday when Iran attacked Israel and there were all these drones and cruise missiles coming in. It was their dome system that protected them, but many of them were headed right for that dome. I mean, it could be, right? You can see how it could happen. All of a sudden, there's a way made for them to rebuild that temple. But halfway through, the Antichrist is going to set himself up in the Holy of Holies and what the Bible calls the abomination that causes desolation and say, all right, now everybody has to worship me. And that's when the Jews will, their eyes will be open, be like, this is not how it is. And you read about this in Daniel chapter 9, that's Old Testament, verse 27, says he, Antichrist, will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7, that's that 7-year period. In the middle of the 7, that's halfway through the tribulation period, he will put an end to sacrifice and offering. By the way, they already have the red heifer to start sacrificing again. And on a wing of the temple, he will set up an abomination that causes desolation until the end that is decreed is poured out. Jesus reiterated this again in the Olivet Discourse where he's teaching on the end times. He says, so when you see standing in the holy place the abomination that causes desolation spoken through the prophet Daniel, let the reader understand and let those who are in Judea flee to the mountains. In my opinion, the devil has with each season somebody earmarked to be Antichrist. A lot of people are like, well, the Antichrist has already been born. He's already in his 40s. And that may or may not be true. And listen, I don't really care. Because I'm not looking for the Antichrist. I'm looking for Jesus Christ. Amen? Amen. I don't care. And besides that, I know what happens to him in the end anyway. Okay? But this is just PB's opinion that in every generation since, because no one knows the day or the hour. You know who that includes? Satan. He doesn't know either. So in my opinion, he has somebody earmarked with each generation to embody his work on the earth. What is his mission? To steal, kill, and destroy. To embody that, to embody evil, to embody everything that opposes God, opposes Jesus. And that the spirit of Antichrist is always at work in the world. 1 John 4 and verse 3. And every spirit that does not confess Jesus is not from God. This is the spirit of Antichrist, which you heard was coming and is now in the world already. The Bible indicates in the book of Revelation that the tribulation period will be marked by three things. A one world government, a one world economy, and a one world religion. You can see how there's constant maneuvering and pressure to do that now. You can also see why so much of the world opposes the United States because the United States backs the nation of Israel. And what they want is to diminish those two nations so that we have a one world religion. A one world government, a one world economy. Look at Revelation 13, 16 through 18. We read about the beast or the Antichrist. It says, also it, the beast, the Antichrist, causes all, both small and great, both rich and poor, both free and slave, to be marked on the right hand or on the forehead so that no one can buy or sell unless he has the mark. That is the name of the beast or the number of his name. This calls for wisdom. Let the one who has understanding calculate the number of the beast, for it is the number of a man, and his number is 666. Okay, so check this out. You can see how all of this is setting up, how technology will be used, right, for this mark, and that you're not going to be able to buy or sell without it. So I use Google Wallet to pay for everything. So convenient. You just tap the little beep and you're done, right? In fact, when I go to a place and they don't have it, I'm like, really, bruh? What are we in the 90s? Let's go. Like, come on, let's catch up. You want me to actually get out physical, a card or paper? And you can see there's a lot of places that they don't even take cash anymore. Like if you go to a baseball game, a Dodger game, and try to pay with cash, it's not going to happen. You have to use electronic payment to pay. So I got a notice, electronic notice on some of my subscriptions that says, hey, heads up, bruh, your payment method is getting ready to expire. And so I looked at my, it was a debit card. I looked at it. It said 3/24, March 24 of 2024, that my debit card was getting ready to expire. And I was like, I better go down to the bank and order, you know, have them give me a new card. So I went down there, and this little girl, the little mousy lady, she's looking, she said, oh, yes, we see that. We see it's getting ready to expire. I'm like, I know, that's why I'm here. Yes, and it says here that we already sent you a card. I didn't get a card. Oh. She's like, okay, well, we're going to have to order you another one. Let me get on the phone, and we'll put a stop on that one. We'll send you out a new one, and it's going to take 7 to 10 business days. 7 to 10 business days. I was like, all right, look, I got this other card. I don't know what the PIN is to it, so I need you to help me establish the PIN for this card. I'll just use that one she says, okay, let me look. It says here that this card was issued to you in 2020, and it was never activated. And you have to activate it within 90 days. Here's the worst part about this story. My wife looked through the mail, and they had sent me the debit cards after they canceled them. So now I'm having to wait 2 weeks for my new cards, and I can't use the card, and I can't use the fancy little phone, and I literally had to go to the bank every day and withdraw my allowance of money for gas and food. And I thought, this is how it's going to be. This is how it's going to be. Like, you can see how it won't be that long. It won't be Google Wallet. It'll be a chip, some kind of a mark, right? It'll have everything. It's going to have your insurance card. It's going to have all of your medical information. It'll have your driver's license. It's going to have your credit cards. It's going to have all of it. And when you go to the hockey game, when you just go, it'll have your hockey tickets on there. You just scan it and be like, come right in. And they're using the retina, right, to ID people. So you can see how this is going to go, where you look into something, because it'll be either on the hand or the forehead, how it's all being set up now, the technology, where we're connected. And it'll be a one-world currency, right? So it won't matter whether you're in Zimbabwe, or you could be in India, or you could be in, you know, Argentina or somewhere. You're just going to use the chip. This is how we're going to get around. And that's how this, the Antichrist, is going to control the whole world. The man of lawlessness will be revealed. Says also that his reign is going to be marked by three things. Write this down. By satanic power. That he's literally going to be controlled by Satan. Possessed by Satan, that he's going to perform false signs and wonders, and that his whole deal is going to be deception and delusion. Now, let me ask you this, family. When you watch the news, does anybody else get the sense that all of this is already, like, set in motion? That everything's already in place for all of this to happen, and you feel the weird, you just sense the weirdness of this one world thing, the globalism, like open borders, you know, everybody just comes and goes as they pleases, and we're going to diminish the power of the dollar, and I mean, it's weird. And you get this sense of, these things are already in order now. So the question is, what is holding the Antichrist back from just stepping up to the plate and be like, it's time? That's number three. When the restrainer is removed. Verses 5-7. Do you remember that when I was still with you, I told you these things, and you know what is restraining him now, so that he may be revealed in his time? For the mystery of lawlessness is already at work. You see, there it is, right? It was at work then, it's at work now. Only he who now restrains it will do so until he is taken out of the way. Now, there's a lot of opinions. Some theorize that that was a Roman emperor that was restraining. Some say it's the archangel Michael, referring to in the Old Testament, that he was holding back some demonic forces. But if you're a pre-tribber like me, I'm a pre-tribber, okay? It is my opinion that the restrainer is the work of the Holy Spirit in the church of Jesus Christ, who is about fulfilling the great commission in our generation, preaching the gospel of Jesus Christ, making disciples of every nation. I want you to imagine for a moment what it will be like when the trumpet sounds and the church is raptured and there are zero Christians on the earth. What will the world look like if there's nobody serving God, nobody worshiping, nobody praying, nobody preaching? You can see how in our own culture, how fast it would degrade. Why do you think the culture is so adamantly opposed to all things Christianity? The perpetual sisters of indulgence, they didn't mock Islam. They mocked Jesus. Why do they do that? Why do they want to diminish Jesus? Why do they want to diminish the church of Jesus? Why does every precinct of education and entertainment mock Christians? Make fun of Christians, diminish Christians. They're skeptical of Christianity. They are skeptical of the Bible. They call into question, why does Richard Dawkins make fun of Christians? Why doesn't he make fun of Buddhists or Hindus or Muslims or anybody else? Because it's the spirit of Antichrist at work in the world, calling into question who Jesus is and who his church is. They want to get the church out of the way to usher in this whole one world thing, this whole globalist thing. Because so long as the church is the church, Satan can't do what he wants to do. We as God's people are called to join the resistance. We are to resist the devil. Come on, somebody. How many know with your life, with your prayer life, with how you live your life, you should be resisting the devil in your neighborhood, in your family, in your community, in your church, in your state, in your country. Anything that you belong to, you should be resisting the devil. Resist him, the Bible says, and he will flee from you. That we are called to do what? Put on, be strong in the Lord and in the power of his might, and to put on the full armor of God, that you may be able to what? Stand against him, to resist him. We're to wrestle with him. Come on, you jujitsu people. You need to roll every day with the devil. Sean yesterday said that he took on like six dudes, just smashed six dudes in the gym. He said normally he just plays with them like a big orca whale just playing with a seal. But yesterday he said he wanted to go hard. That's what he said. And so he just started pinning people. I need to come watch this, right? I need to come watch Sean take some people down. In fact, I would pay money to watch Sean take like Jared and Yancey down. That would be fun. And I'm not going to pay him money to take me down. I just want to watch him take somebody else down. But he says, we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers of darkness. That's who we're wrestling, and that we need to be people who are fighting. Come on, we are fighting the devil in our community. This is why when we leave our house every Sunday night, we say we are putting on the full armor of God. the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, the shoes that are fitted for the readiness of the gospel of peace. We take up the shield of faith, knowing it quenches every fiery dart of the enemy, and the sword of the Spirit. By the way, that's the only offensive weapon. That's the only one you need, baby. That's the only one you need is the word of God. I'm telling you right now, do you remember when Jesus was in the wilderness, he was being tempted by the devil? How did he fight him? With the word. Hey, man, if you really are the Son of God, why don't you cause these stones to become bread? He says, because it is written, man shall not live by bread alone, but by every word that proceeds from the mouth of God. That's how he fought him. And that's what we need. And we talk about how we're praying that as we leave the church and we go into the community, we leave this place, go to the marketplace, that everywhere we go, the kingdom of Satan is pushed back. And the kingdom of Jesus is advanced. And we keep on this mission until the day either we go home or the trumpet sounds, baby. And then we don't have to fight anymore. We let him do our fighting for us. Come on now. Amen? And we do this. Why? Why do you think we need to be full of the Holy Spirit? We need to be baptized in the Holy Spirit. We need to be endued with power. In Acts chapter 2, the word was dunamis. Acts chapter 1, you shall receive power. The word is dunamis. Man, we need to have some Christians that have some explosive power. The world has seen enough of Christians that have zero power. You need to get yourself in shape spiritually, fam. How do you do that? The same way you get yourself in shape physically. You go to the gym, you work out, right? That's why the Word of God teaches you need to work out your salvation with fear and trembling. That Paul talked about, it says, in the same way that you are attentive to your physical fitness, you need to be attentive to your spiritual fitness. How does that happen? Through the disciplines. By giving God the first part of your day and in the word and in prayer, by giving God the first part of your income and your first fruits and offering and tithe, by giving God the first day of the week in worship. That's how you work out. That's how you get strong spiritually. I want the worship gathering to be a gathering of people who are strong in the Lord and in the power of his might. People who are doing battle against the enemy. People who are leaving and every piece of ground your feet walk on, that's why we say that, is yours to take. That you have dominion and authority. Why? Because you're Christ's representatives. You're Christ's ambassadors. And the same power that raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you. And it quickens your mortal body. And so we don't know when the day of the Lord is coming. We know that these things have to be happen first, that the rebellion has to come or people stop listening. And if you want to do it sequentially, the restrainer is removed. The church is no longer here to do battle against the devil every day. And number three, the man of lawlessness is revealed. And then the coming of the Lord will happen. So we don't know when that restrainer, we can sense the rebellion thing, but we don't know when the cup's going to get full. And we don't know when the Father's going to say to the Son, that's it, go get my church. We don't know when that day is going to come. Anybody that tells you they do is run. That's fake news, right? But what we do need to do is be ready. And how are we ready, family? As we bring the service to a close tonight, how do we make ourselves ready? Well, the first place that we make ourselves ready is that we repent. And we confess our sins and we're born again. Jesus said that in John 3 and verse 3. Remember, Nicodemus says, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He says, I tell you the truth, no one will have eternal life unless he is born again. Remember, Nicodemus is like, born again, I don't get it, dude. Like, what am I supposed to do, crawl back up in my mom? Like, really? That's weird. Jesus said, no, flesh gives birth to flesh. The spirit gives birth to spirit. So we're born again spiritually. How do we do that? By putting our faith in Jesus. By saying, you know, God, I recognize I'm a sinner. I recognize that I failed you. I recognize that I deserve to be punished. And I'm sorry, God. Man, when's the last time you prayed that prayer? When's the last time that in your brokenness, in your own realization of your own sinful nature, that you were just broken before God and you just crumbled before Him and that you didn't have anything else to say other than I'm sorry. Please forgive me. And it is in the brokenness and in the repentance and it is in the confession of sin and in putting faith in Jesus to forgive us and to make us alive in Christ that we are saved. And I'm here to tell you right now, if you've not taken that step, yesterday I was out on the golf course with one of the friends of mine that I'm really working on, praying for, trying to get him to church, witnessing to him. You know, I'm just like, God, you put me there for a reason, man. My brother Eric here, he's another believer from the country club, and you know, he's coming to the Lynx Fellowship. I'm telling you, we got the jiu-jitsu. We're gonna get all of Gracie Jiu-Jitsu Gym saved. We're gonna get that country club saved. And I was working on him, praying for him, witnessing to him. And he stopped in the middle of our round. He says, look, they're breaking into the master's coverage to tell us that Iran is attacking Israel. And I'm like, this is, man, dude, I'm just telling you right now that the Bible predicts this. This is going to happen. And with specificity, and this is thousands of years ago, the Bible predicts that the nations are going to come against Israel and attack Israel. And that one nation from the north will be led down by the jaw. And many scholars believe that nation's Russia. He said, you got to be ready, man. You got to live ready. You got to live ready. Are you ready? Have you repented? Have you confessed? Have you asked the Lord for forgiveness? Have you put your faith and trust in Jesus to be the forgiver of your sins? And the leader of your life, to take it a step further. It's not just about how people are saved. It's also about how saved people should live. Repenting and being born again is not the end, it's the beginning. Come on, somebody help pastor preach right now. That while we're still here, we should live lives that honor God. That's how we live rapture ready. That with each day and say, Lord, whether I eat or drink or whatever I do it all to the glory of God. And then the third thing is that we need to be about the Father's business. That we understand that we're not just here to go to work and pay bills, go to work and pay bills, go to work and pay bills, get in a Winnebago, go on vacation, come back home, go to work, pay bills, go to work, to pay bills. Like do this for 30 years until you build up enough money to get a gold watch and then you buy a Winnebago, sell your house and travel around until your days on earth are over. There's more to life than that. Man, is there ever more to life than that? We must be about the Father's business. And so that means when you work on AT&T contracts and you're doing things for that company, that you're doing it all to the glory of God to further His kingdom. This means that when you're driving a truck so that our roads can be paved, Yancey, you're doing it all to the glory of God to further His kingdom. That every day you're seeking, you're looking, you're asking the Holy Spirit to open up doors of opportunity for you to pray people. Not just so that the kingdom happens here in these four walls, that the kingdom happens out there. That you bring the kingdom with you out there. That you lay hands on the sick and they recover. Man, you never, listen, I encourage you this week, every one of you guys, you say, I'm going to be about the Father's business. And if you don't know what else to do, if you find somebody that's hurting, somebody that's broken, somebody that's upset, somebody that you can tell when they're off, and you say, hey, man, are you okay? Is everything going on? They say, I'm just dealing with some stuff. You say, man, I don't know what you're dealing with. I don't need to know what you're dealing with, but can I pray for you? Man, I've never had anybody say, nope, you cannot pray for me. People are like, sure. I mean, even if they're not believers, sure, you can pray for me. And man, I'm telling you right there, I've sensed, I've just put my hand on their shoulder. I say, Lord, I just lift my friend to you. Lord, I don't know what she's dealing with, but I pray even now, right now, that she will sense and feel the power of your Holy Spirit working on her heart. And Lord, I pray that you will intervene and whatever that she needs, that you'll bring it to her. And Lord, that above all, that she will turn her heart to you. and love and honor and serve you. And I pray this in the name of Jesus. Amen. How long did that take? That's the Father's business, Ryan. And if we all live this way, we are doing what God has called us to do, to be ready. Did you learn anything from the preaching of the Word of God tonight? Would you stand your feet all over the house? And if you're in this room, you know, I don't pretend to know where everybody is spiritually. And for some of you, you know, you come to a house like this and it's a different experience, man. Welcome to the club. There's a lot of people here that it was a new experience for them when they started coming here. But it, you know, it's kind of like you get a taste and then you just want to keep coming back. But I don't pretend to know where you are with the Lord. There may be people in this room that you are not right with God, that there's sin between you and Him, and you need to take that step of faith, of believing and putting your faith in Jesus, confessing and repenting and being born again. So with every head bowed and every eye closed, I don't want to embarrass you. This is just between me, you, and God. If you're here today and you say, that is 100% me, Pastor. There are things between me and God that I need to get squared away. And I felt the conviction of the Holy Spirit drawing me and compelling me to Jesus tonight. I'm going to count to three. When I get to three, you raise your hand. We're going to pray. And every one of us has been in this place. So you don't need to feel ashamed or embarrassed because we all need forgiveness. One, say, that is me, Pastor. I need to make things right with God. Two, three, all over the room. If that's you, would you lift your hand up? God bless you and you and you. Oh, man. God bless you, man. God bless you. And several in the back, this is way cool. I'm telling you, man, this makes everything we do worth it. God bless you guys. Man, wow. This isn't normally how we do this here, but I just feel led by the Lord to do this. If you raise your hand right now, would you take that next step and would you join me up here at this altar? You don't have to do anything weird. Just come stand up here. Come on. All you guys in the back that raised your hand, there were several of you over here. God bless you guys. Come on up here. And we're going to pray together. Man, yeah, let's hear it for these guys. This is, man, it takes some boldness. He's like, oh, he got all eyes on you. But man, I'm just telling you, Jesus said this. Come on over here. Thanks, Isaac. Love you, dude. Jesus said this, if you're ashamed of me before men, I'm going to be ashamed of you before my Father. So by doing this, you say, I'm not ashamed. And there is nothing for you to be ashamed of. Because again, we're all in the same boat. We all need forgiveness. And can I get a line of fired up Christians to come stand behind these guys and we're going to pray together. Amen. This is a beautiful, 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 beautiful moment. God bless you guys. All right. I need everybody with somebody behind him. Put your hand on the shoulder. Let's pray. The rest of you, would you extend your hands forward and let's all pray this prayer together. And those of you that came forward, if you would do this, this is the universal posture of surrender. It's just the lifting of hands. Would you do that with me and just pray this prayer with me right now? Say, dear God, I come to you. I surrender my life to you. I know I've sinned against you. For that, I'm so sorry. Please forgive me, God. I welcome you to come into my life. Forgive me of all my sins. Make me a new creature in Christ Jesus. I believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross in my place for my sins, and that he rose from the grave on the third day. From this moment forward, Jesus, I'm going to serve you until my life is over or you come take me home. I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Let a roar come up from the family. Come on. Amen. Stay here. Don't go anywhere. We're going to pray the blessing over you. Luke chapter 15, read it. It's the story of how God sees things when somebody's lost is found. There's three stories. It's the story of the lost sheep, the story of the lost coin, and the story of the lost son. So I'm going to give you that as an assignment this week, Luke chapter 15. And with each one, there was a great celebration when that which was lost was found. And Jesus said, "There, I tell you the truth, there is more celebration in heaven over one lost person who comes home than there is in 99 that show up at church." So our whole purpose is for this, and we celebrate you. And right tonight, right now, the angels are throwing a party, man, and your name's on a banner. This lost person has come home. So welcome home. Let me pray the blessing over you. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord cause his face to shine upon you. May the Lord be gracious to you. May the Lord turn his face towards you and give you his peace. And we put the name of Jesus all over you and declare that you are blessed to be a blessing. And now we leave, not from the church, but as the church, dressed in the full armor of God. We put on the helmet of salvation, the breastplate of righteousness, the belt of truth, the shoes that are fitted for the readiness of the gospel of peace. We take up the shield of faith, knowing it quenches every fiery dart of the enemy, and the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God. And we declare that every piece of ground our feet walk on is ours to take. And we pray that as we leave this place and go into the marketplace, may the kingdom of Satan be pushed back and the kingdom of Jesus advanced. And we pray this in the name of Jesus, the strong Son of God. And all of God's people said, amen.